Hi, and welcome to The Existential Coach. In this week's episode, I want to talk about insight and compliance, or insight versus compliance. I'll start off by defining how I'm thinking about insight and what that means, and we'll explore it throughout the podcast and get a better sense of how insight plays out in our lives and how it comes up against compliance. And so after talking a little bit about insight, we'll talk about compliance and define it. So what is insight? Well, insight in its most fundamental experience, you could call it, is a generative process. That is, it's something is created. So let's say we've read a paragraph in a book, and then we read a paragraph in another book, and then we read a paragraph in a third book. And then we ask ourselves, how do I link these three different paragraphs from these three different books? And what we're generating is something that's unique. It's not something that would be found in any of the three sources, because we're not simply doing a summary of what each thing is. Rather, we're trying to come up with a creative, insightful way that links these different things together. So this is what an insight is. It's a generative process. It's a creative process. Now, on the other hand, we have compliance. And compliance, I think, is pretty obvious. You can think of it in terms of complying to the law or complying to certain policies. And that is very much the case. I want to introduce another dimension to this, which is compliance as bad faith. And as we've talked about this before, and drawing upon Jean-Paul Sartre, the notion of bad faith is the idea that we are this kind of persona or character that is socially constructed, that we are. And one of the examples he gives most famously in his writings is of the waiter who is acting in bad faith because the waiter believes that they are a waiter, when really the waiter is playing the role of a waiter. It's a job, it's a service, it's a position, it's all of these kinds of things, but it's a social construct. And it's not that this is in and of itself good or bad, so much as the belief that that's what you are is bad faith. And it's bad faith because we're not engaging in this kind of generative process of understanding our own freedom. And so that becomes a question of what is freedom? And how do we engage in our relationships with others? But more fundamentally right now, how do we engage in the relationship of freedom within ourselves? So if we just quickly use the example of insight, and we say that there's three different things that we've read. And you could even do this as an experiment. Just take three books or three articles or whatever it is, and pretty much randomly just read a chunk until there's some idea, until there's something that emerges in some way that you get a point of some kind. Then read another one, and you can add to that. But for now, do three, four. And then sit and start jotting down ideas as to how those things link. Now, in that experience, you might say, well, I want this to be good. I want this to mean something. I want to get this right. So that's a form of compliance in the sense that there's an expectation created as to what something should be and that we need to meet that in order to be safe. So compliance offers us a kind of safety by fitting into the social construct. And I think you can see where I'm going with compliance and bad faith is that by fitting into the social construct, we give ourselves a kind of pass or a kind of cover from the uncertainty of insight. Because as a generative process, we're not really sure what we're going to come up with. So, for example, when I do this podcast, I decided I would jot down kind of a series of bullets on my computer. So one of them, the first one says define insight, generative. The second one says define compliance following quote-unquote bad faith. And what I've been doing is just improvising based upon those two things as I am talking about the topic of insight and compliance, and as I am working my way through a kind of path. So in a sense, we can imagine ourselves walking through a forest, and there's trees and shrubs and rocks and creeks and animals and every birds and everything you can imagine. And we are looking for a path. We are looking for a way through it. We never actually leave the forest, right? We're just going through the forest. So within that, we're having a kind of experience. And this is where I want to try and use this forest analogy to make a reference to intersubjectivity. Now, intersubjectivity is a field of study within psychology. You may have heard of self-psychology, intersubjectivity. But I'm thinking of it, and that's applicable, of course, but I'm thinking of it if we go back to Edmund Husserl and the idea of intersubjectivity, phenomenology, and the way in which the individual is actually experienced in the world, of the world, as a phenomenon. In other words, we're not bracketed off from the world per se. We actually exist in and of the world. So when we're walking through the forest, just to use that as an analogy, we are creating a path. It's generative, but we're also thinking, am I doing it right? So there's compliance. And there's this dynamic that is going on back and forth. So maybe we just take the path that's really well worn. But maybe something sparks our curiosity. It's just off the path. Or maybe we need to go to the washroom. So we decide we're going to go off the path, go to the washroom. Something happens. And we at that point decide I need to do something different. So in that experience, what I'm kind of loosely referring to as this kind of intersubjective experience through the analogy of the forest, we are in relationship to our environment. It's not that we just control our environment. So it's not like I'm walking along a path and I just will say, I want to go in this new direction, so I'm going to will that there's a path there. And all of a sudden, magically, a new path appears. I don't have that kind of omnipotent control. I am engaged in a kind of subjective experience that is dynamic. It is constantly changing, but it's not omnipotent in the sense that I can dominate it. Now, as you can probably start to see, when we think about compliance and we think about the idea of dominating the subjective experience, this is where we can effectively colonize our intersubjectivity through the rules and regulations as defined by compliance as reference to bad faith. And this will have, as I'll talk in a moment, a dehumanizing effect. And it's a kind of mechanized way of looking at human relationships. However, I want to point out that it's not simply the case that we're adopting a mechanized approach. It's that we're also getting something subjectively from that escape from our own sense of uncertainty. So it's not simply that I'm following a policy. It's that I am not experiencing uncertainty. And that's the shift here. To be compliant is not simply to follow, it is to get relief from the existential crisis of experiencing ourselves as alienated, as uncertain, as not having meaning, as not having purpose, as death anxiety, and so on. And all of this is enfolded into this notion that if I can follow the rules, if I can be compliant, then I will be freed from the uncertainty of life. And that, again, goes back to this idea of compliance and bad faith. So just to kind of put these three pieces together, insight, compliance, and intersubjectivity, the insight is this creative, generative process. Compliance is this adherence to something that, as I'm defining it in our discussion here today, as it pertains to bad faith and this idea that we are the construct, that we are not actually free. And intersubjectivity actually changes the relationship of the so-called subject to be something that is intersubject. Or intra-subject, which means it's selves, it's multiple selves, it's a dynamic self, it's changing. It is generative. And if it is compliant, it is not generative. Obviously, it's following some kind of system, some kind of protocol. And what we're getting from that, again, is this escape from the uncertainty of what might unfold, what might happen. And I'll use an example in a little bit, but And that all comes under the umbrella of intersubjectivity in terms of what are our relationships? Do we try and box those relationships into some form of certainty that alleviates us from the anxiety of not knowing. So go back to our three paragraph kind of reading exercise. And if you're doing it and if you're reading three different paragraphs and trying to come up with an idea and you're starting to feel anxious about it, or you feel really good about it, and then you read your ideas later and you don't like them, you're experiencing how there is no real certainty to a process that is constantly regenerating, and that the insights beget more insights, which beget more insights. And that's this creative unfolding. There's this saying, and a friend of mine in academia said, is you don't want answers, you want better questions. And it's very much this notion of you're not trying to come up with compliant protocols and procedures. You're actually trying to come up with a more nuanced understanding of how things work. And another quick example is how critical theory is paradoxically criticized, but done so in such an irrational way. But it makes sense to criticize something that in and of itself demands insight in an environment that seeks to alleviate itself of the crisis of insight, right? It's threatened by insight, whether that's generated through different people's perspective of religion, gender, and so on. The idea of being able to reframe the social construct, hence critical theory, actually creates an anxiety. Actually, another example of this is my father, who worked as a civil engineer in the government. He retired way back in the very beginning of 2000, but his job was to be able to evaluate how long things took. So it was creating all of these little modules and what it was involved in the task of running the various different things at the passport office, which is where he worked. And so they would say, okay, there's this project we want to do, and these are the parameters, and then they would ask him for an estimate. So he would go and do his thing, and he would come back and say, okay, the project will take, you know, 1 year or 3 years or whatever it was. And that way they could build budgets, create timelines, and so on and so forth. But something he said to me, which is interesting, is he said, I never assumed the system was right if there was human error. I always assumed the system was wrong whenever there was human error. And then he said, because that was my way to ensure I did not dehumanize the process. And so even though he was working in a medium that was actually creating policy, hence compliance, his sense was if one person did something that changed the numbers, they were right. The structure was wrong. So it was a generative way of looking at compliance. And that's something I'll come back to later, because yes, I'm talking about it as insight versus compliance, but there is this ongoing tango between the two. So now I want to go into this idea of subjective overlaps. And this will relate very much to this idea of this tango between the two, that there can be different subjective needs that can come into contact and conflict arises. Now, if you recall, the very first podcast I did was called Conflict as Potential. And this spoke to the way in which conflict is a part of our lives. The question is, what is our relationship with conflict? So here I'm going to draw upon two helpful terms, I think, in thinking about how we may respond in a situation to conflict. So let's just think of an interpersonal dynamic. It might be with a partner or a friend or a coworker, whomever. So the first one is called the forward edge, and the second one is called the trailing edge. Now, what does this mean? If we come in, so the forward edge relates to hope and the trailing edge relates to dread. So if I come into relation with someone and we are talking and it is feeling exciting and I'm feeling a sense of hope, this is the forward edge. There's the feeling like we're growing, there's a sense of potential, there's all these different things that are happening that are exciting, invigorating, that are feel like insight, feel like it's generative. Conversely, if I have a conversation with somebody or an experience with somebody and it feels like everything is a problem, everything's a dead end, everything is a trailing edge, then there's a sense of dread. My life isn't going anywhere. This doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean anything to me. It's not where I want to be in my life, and so on. Then that's a sense of existential dread. And that precipitates this notion of uncertainty, as we've talked before, about what does it mean to not know and what is our relationship with not knowing. How do we connect with this idea of the unknowing in our life? circling back to an insight, well, can we creatively draw from that experience of unknowing, of not knowing? So let me just give a more concrete example. So your boss tells you to do something. You do it, however, you adapt it in a way to fit your approach. The same objective is met as for, and that objective, you know, as you understood it. So there could obviously be room there, but the same objective is met as you understood it. But your boss says you are not in compliance. Were you in compliance? This is kind of the fundamental problem with compliance, is it needs to be framed in a way like any language. So there needs to be a methodology, or what's commonly referred to as a due process. And the function of a methodology or due process is to ensure that these kinds of breakdowns that occur in communication are tracked. So you're kind of moving step by step by step, as opposed to just jumping over a whole bunch of steps. You're saying, okay, well, where was this break? Something happened in that little example where your boss told you to do something. You thought the objective was X. You thought you were doing it. Yes, you were doing it in your own way, but you thought you were well-intentioned and you thought you were doing it very, very well. And they said you were not in compliance, which means something somewhere went off the rails. Now, if we circle back to this idea of the intersubjective experience and the idea of hope and forward edge and dread and the trailing edge, what if this boss felt threatened? You did it in a way that was different. Let's say for the sake of argument, it was better. Better just meaning here, it was different than what they had ever thought, and it achieved the same end. However, if they've been trained in the language of compliance, they had one way to get from point A to point B, and you demonstrated that there is another way. If they have no relationship, if they are acting in bad faith, if they are operating within this umbrella of compliance, if they see it as their way is the only way, and I'll talk about why that is in a moment, but if they see it as their way is the only way, then there is nothing else that can be generated. There is no other room for insight. So what that means is there is no method or due process. Why am I saying this, and why am I hammering on this idea of methodology and due process? Just like for us to speak to each other, we need to have the due process or the methodology of a shared language. Similarly with any procedures. So if we're going to play sports, or if we're going to play chess, or if we're going to play a kind of music together, or whatever it is that we're going to do, there is a methodology, there is a due process, there is a language in place. And within that, there's a certain level of fluidity that can happen in adapting. However, you know, my background playing jazz is very different than some of the people I've worked with whose background has been pop music. And I would be in the studio on some session or something, this many years ago, and I'd be thinking, okay, great, let's just start recording, right? Like, you got some sounds, everything's good, let's just start playing. And they're spending a lot of time on the kick, and I'm thinking, sounds like a kick, let's move on. It's not that I'm right and they're wrong, or they're right and I'm wrong. It's that my language of understanding is not predicated upon how important that kick sound is. I'm like, yeah, it sounds good, let's play. They're thinking, no, no, no. There's a very specific sound we want from that kick. So it's not that somebody's right or wrong. It's that there was a breakdown in methodology. There was a breakdown in due process. I wasn't understanding that the way they're approaching music, that quality in the kick is very significant. And they weren't seeing that for me. I just wanted to play, right? It was just, I wanted to improvise. I wanted to get out there and do it as a jazz musician. So again, it's not right or wrong, but there was a complete and utter breakdown in methodology, a complete and utter breakdown in due process. Now, it was fine and we did the session. It was all good. But just to come back to the example of the boss, if they are feeling a sense of dread and that turns into this intersubjective overlap, which creates a sense of uncertainty, here we end up in the situation where they are being triggered. They're having a fear response. They're feeling anxious. You have shown them there's another way of doing something, and they don't want that to happen. They want you to comply to their way. And this is where we get to power and reason. Because they want you to follow their methodology in their way, they see their identity as being affixed to, and this is why the bad faith thing is so key, the role that they're playing, that they are that role. And so if you do it differently, again, you weren't trying to do anything other than the goal as you understood it, and to do it in a way that made sense to you. So you weren't doing anything mischievous or in any way negative. You were just doing it like I had suggested earlier. You just read three paragraphs and you came up with an insight. And it would be the same for me to say, oh, well, you came up with the wrong insight. And you're like, well, what are you talking about? The goal, the objective was to come up with an insight, and I did. And I'm saying, yeah, but it's supposed to be this. That would become really disorienting. That's gaslighting, something we've talked about before. But this idea of power and reason, this is where status starts to essentially take the role of reason. So what is the question is what is understood as right and true? Is that the method, or is that due process, or is it the result? And is the result associated with somebody's identity, your boss's identity? And so if you do it in a different way, effectively to them, you have attacked them. This was not your intention. So let's kind of review this is to move through this. So we got insight, we got compliance, has these two dynamics that are kind of in tango, so to speak. We got intersubjectivity and the overlap of our subject, our intentions, our boss's intentions or our friend's intentions. We have the effect that is a result of this interaction, the forward edge hope or the trailing edge of dread. We have within that a sense of uncertainty. Now, uncertainty can be hopeful, right? It can be like optimism, the sense of openness. There's a horizon of potential that is uncertainty, but there's a feeling of optimism toward it. And similarly, there can be a sense of dread about uncertainty that everything's falling apart. The world's a shithole, filled with shitty little people scared shitless, and there's nothing we can do about it. So it can go either way. And then our example was your boss tells you to do something, you do it. However, you adapt it to fit your approach. The same objective is met as you understood it, but they saw that you were not in compliance, and they say that you were not in compliance. This, as I was saying, is a breakdown in methodology and due process. And we add to this power as reason, not power and reason, but power as reason. And we get to this question of what is understood as right and true. Is it the method or is it the status? So that's kind of a summation thus far. And it would be easy to leave it there and say, okay, well, this is really frustrating. It's not fair. And we're all done. But this all kind of builds to a couple of questions that I want to explore and then leave you with, which is, do we have time for insight? Do we have time to think about anything? If the container of our experience is such that it fundamentally excludes us having different ways of doing things and that being okay, then it says to me that we actually do not have time for insight. And so is compliancy a byproduct of our inability to listen? In other words, because we don't have time to listen, because we haven't learned to listen, because we went to school and were taught the test, because we did a task and we followed the rules, because we now work in jobs where we're constantly assessing and evaluating each other, there is always the overriding impetus of compliance and not the open horizon which would invite us to explore the potential of that which we have yet to understand, therefore yet to have built upon and explored and so on. That idea of we're not looking for answers, we're looking for better questions. So do we fear insight as a threat? And does this fear kind of dethrone us and in so doing throw us into this state of existential crisis where we really feel that if we aren't able to maintain the kind of control where people are doing what we want in the way we want, then they are attacking us. And so going back to that forest example, one of the things I said, which was kind of absurd, which was you're walking down the forest path. You have a desire to check something that's off the path. Then you think, I'm just going to magically make a path that means it's no longer off the path. that's what's happening in our thinking. This is a form of narcissistic, omnipotent thinking that excludes the fact that we have to engage with the environment and the people and the dynamics in our world, and that they are intersecting subjectivities, that these are dynamics that are occurring, and within that is the potential for insight. So if we go back to the boss example, notice what's completely missed. There's actually something within that example that I've said a few times that is such an obvious opportunity, which is the boss can see that somebody has found a way to meet the objective that is different, and that boss can celebrate A, the dynamic of their relationship is mutually respectful, and B, that there is another way of doing it, which makes it more robust. And this is why compliance fundamentally undermines its own necessity, which is, we say compliance is so we have this sense of rule and regulation, the sense of order. But really what it does is it creates a kind of monoculture, which undermines our relational bonds. Because when I've been in environments, when I've been around people who are operating under the compliancy doctrine, they are not connected. They don't care about the workplace, the school place, the relationship. They don't care. They are just doing it because it's a paycheck. They're doing it because it's accreditation. They're doing it because of some external factor. There is nothing in that system, that psychological system, that intersubjective system, that they actually care about. They're doing it for the money most often. But if you remove that piece, if you took that out, they would be gone. And so we're now talking about living our lives in a way where we are operating under the defense of compliance, which then stops us from interacting in a genuine way with people and experiencing insight, which is a generative process. And we are then moving into the trailing edge of dread, focusing only on the problems and not on how to grow through insight, through different ways of seeing and understanding the world in which we live. So this idea goes from insight and compliance and gets all the way down to, do we fear our own openness, our own curiosity? And the answer is yes. Compliance becomes a way to avoid our own subjectivity. Yet, when I look around at the world, what do I see? I see people trying to, in some way, define their subjective self. And they're doing it in a variety of different ways. And this says that the question of compliance is something that we are pressed up against as we start to explore who we are in terms of gender, race, religion, and so on, and we start to look past these modes of compliance that operationally define in a dehumanizing way that which is the forward edge of hope, and that which moves us towards uncertainty, and that which invites us to take steps into these overlapping subjective experiences, and where that may lead, and we don't know. So, we talked about insight, we talked about compliance, we talked about these inter and overlapping subjectivities, we talked about hope and dread, uncertainty, and we've talked about methodology and due process. But at the end of the day, a way of thinking about this is, a more parsimonious way of thinking about this is, we can generate our experiences through insight, or we can close ourselves off and engage in a form of bad faith compliance. And yes, we may protect ourselves from the uncertainty, but from that which we protect ourselves is the opportunity through which we may discover ourselves.